Hey there, Vineyard. Happy New Year to you. God bless you for this new year. Happy 2022. I hope this year is going to be much, much better than the last 2 years. And that we'll be out of lockdown soon, meeting together at the Gomaris really soon again. Man, I really look forward to seeing all of you again in one room, worshiping. I really look forward to it. But hey, right now we're still in lockdown. It's the way it is. Hopefully this will end soon and then we'll see each other again. We are kicking off a new message series today and I'm very, very excited about it because it is about the book of Revelation. Ooh, I know, Revelation. It's such an exciting book. It's such a challenging book. It's such a tricky book. It's such a freaky book. But hold on, we're going to kind of ease our way into this. We're starting off now with a 7-week series on the 7 letters to the 7 churches addressed in the book of Revelation. And then we'll pick up the rest, the tricky and the freaky parts, much later. I'm going to need to do a lot more preparation for that. So we're kind of easing our way into it. So we're starting with a 7-week series on the 7 letters to the 7 churches that were the first receivers of the book of Revelation. So I'm very excited about it. And please join me on the strip. So I'm going to start off today with a bit of an introduction message. It's a lot of teaching, a lot of information. So tune in. And I hope this will help you and kind of set you up for the rest of the series. And we're going to look at the first letter, the letter to the church in Ephesus. So before we look at the letters, we need to get a big picture of Revelation. And I've bought a few commentaries on Revelation, started out in it, reading the introductions. And all of them start with the book of Revelation is a very hard book to interpret. I'm like, yeah, I know. That's why I got this really big and really expensive book. No kidding. Please help me out. But it's the setting is, it is a difficult book to interpret. And there's a lot of interpretations and ways of dealing with it flying around. We'll look at that a little bit and kind of discern our way through that. So, a few sentences from the opening of the book of Revelation. Revelation 1, verse 9 to 11 says, I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet saying, write what you see in a book, and send it to the 7 churches, to Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, and Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. So, Revelation is written by John. And, of course, our mind first goes to the Apostle John, who wrote the Gospel, most probably wrote the 3 letters from John. And then, you know, according to tradition, also wrote the revelations, revelation that he received and wrote down and sent to the churches. A lot of scholars say that it's very possible that it's not the apostle, but some other guy who was very well known in these churches in modern day Turkey, then called Minor Asia. Very possible as well that he was a traveling prophet, someone with a recognized ministry and position, a leader in the church. I think all in all, it doesn't really matter for us today who exactly wrote it. It's in the canon of the New Testament, and that gives it its authority. It was put on there on purpose by the Holy Spirit. And so it just carries that biblical authority, no matter who actually wrote it. And it's written in a time of persecution. So the church is growing. This is late first century. The church is growing, is expanding all over the Greek world, the Roman Empire, and it's hitting some opposition, sometimes even organized opposition, like persecution of Christians. And there's a lot of false teaching going around. So as the church is growing, people are getting interested, people are getting different ideas. Of course, in the time of the New Testament, they didn't yet have the New Testament to kind of check. And so theology was in that sense forming still based on the teachings of the apostles. And there was a lot of distraction. There was a lot of false teaching going around. And these are the 2 main threats that the church is facing. Persecution from the outside, false teaching from the inside. And you'll see these addressed in the whole book of Revelation, especially in the seven letters. Now, traditionally, there are four different ways that the book of Revelation is interpreted. And let me just go through them with you quickly to get understanding of how this book has been handled throughout the centuries. First of all, there's the preterist view, which basically says that the book of Revelation was for the first readers. It's describing historical events that happened in the first and second century, whenever, and basically everything that you read about in the book of Revelation has already happened, because they were facing these persecutions, there were these Roman empires, and emperors that were persecuting this and this and this. So everything you find fulfilled in the first and second century. Then there's another view, that's the historical view. It basically says that everything in the book of Revelation is ongoing fulfillment. So it describes historical events that happen throughout history. So it could be 1st, 2nd century, 5th, 12th century, whenever. It could be today, tomorrow. So history is unfolding. That's the book of Revelation. Now, a very popular view today is the futurist view, which basically says that everything that you find here happens in the last 14 or 7 years of the world before the second coming of Christ, either before or after a rapture of all believers. For those of you familiar with the Left Behind series, I read pretty much all of the books because my aunt actually translated them from English to Dutch. She's a translator, that's what she does for a living. And so I actually read most of the books, but I stopped reading them when I started studying theology because I realized it wasn't very theologically sound how they handled the book of Revelation. But you'll find it, and especially now during this pandemic and all this conspiracy stuff, and you'll see a lot of people looking to the book of Revelation for an explanation of what's happening. And you find that like in Revelation 13, like with the mark of the beast and this and that, like throughout history, there have been a lot of people who look at Revelation and look at things happening in the world at that time, and seeing them fulfilled, and seeing like, oh, the end of the world is coming, the eschaton is coming, it's happening now, we're in like the 7 years of tribulation or whatever. So this is a very dominant view at the moment. Now there's another view, and that's the idealistic view, which basically says that it's all good and well, but it doesn't describe historical events. It just describes the cosmic battle between good and evil, and Christ as the victor in a very symbolic way. So it's just meant to inspire, but it's not about historical events. So which one is it going to be? Which one are we going to take? It's quite an important choice to make, because you'll end up with very different conclusions and a way of positioning yourself as a reader when you approach the book of Revelation. So what is the answer? Well, the approach that I'm going to take towards Revelation, and I follow people far smarter than me, like N.T. Wright and George Eldon Ladd in this, following an ecclesiastic view of the book of Revelation, which basically takes very seriously all of the four different approaches: preterist, historical, futurist, and idealistic. Like it's all of the above. It's such a complex, it's such a multi-layered book. There's no one good answer in a way, but it's a mosaic of all of the above. It's describing many historical events. It goes much further than just a very simplistic explanation. So that's what we'll do. We'll take an ecclesiastic view of the book of Revelation, which is the more complicated one and a more sort of one in that holds everything in tension, but takes very seriously what it says there. So this is what we're going to do. You see the book of Revelation as apocalyptic prophecy. And basically, it describes historical events, certainly also in the first century and throughout history and probably in the future. So it describes historical events with the eschaton in mind. The eschaton is the end of the world as we know it. The book of Revelation doesn't describe like the end of the world. It actually describes the renewal of heaven and earth. That's the whole conclusion. That's what it all kind of leads up to. And so it describes things that happen today in view of the eschaton. And this is actually a very a thing that happens a lot in the biblical writings, in the prophecies in the Bible. Take, for example, how Amos describes the fall of Israel, overpowered by the Assyrians. He describes it in an apocalyptic way, as if the whole world is ending. And Isaiah does the same when it comes to Babylon overpowering Judah. You'll find this in Joel when he describes the day of the Lord. It's like the whole world is ending. And he's speaking into a direct context, like then. He's prophesying not just towards like the future whenever, but he's prophesying into the here and now in view of what's going to happen later. Jesus actually does this in the book of Mark. I think it's Mark. He talks about the fall of Jerusalem, which actually happened AD 70, so 70 after Christ. But he talks about it in an apocalyptic kind of way. So he describes an historical event in view of the eschaton. So the imminent historical events are a type of or a prelude to the eschaton, the a kind of end of the world as it is today and the renewal of all things by God, which you'll read about in the final chapters of Revelation. So there's a multi-layeredness in this book. It describes things that have happened, are happening, and will happen. That's how we need to approach the book of Revelation, when you ask me. And it's meant to encourage Christians of all times, in view of the tensions that they're living through, in view of the opposition that they're living through, in view of the tribulations they're going through. It's meant to encourage. The book of Revelation is not meant to freak you out. It is not meant to prepare your apocalypse survival kit or anything like that. It's not meant to give you a sort of timeline which you can fill in and kind of find the signs of the times and this and that, and this will happen, this will happen. And it's meant to encourage you. It's meant to make you aware of what is going on. It's meant to give you an insight in how God sees the unfolding of history. It's a peek behind the curtain. It's a revelation. It's an uncovering of how God sees the unfolding of history, the spiritual ideas behind it, the spiritual battle that's going on behind what we see. So the book of Revelation is relevant for all times. It's relevant for us today, not because of the pandemic, but just because we're Christians and we're living through tensions, we're living through tribulations, challenges, all kinds of things. It's relevant for us. It's relevant for the first readers. It's relevant for readers of all times. And it will be relevant for people, even if they're living through maybe the last couple of scenes or whatever, like however that would work out in the future. So it's going to be relevant for any reader of any time. So now on to the seven letters. This was just a general introduction to the book of Revelation. We'll do a longer, bigger one, a deeper dive into that when we do the sermon series on, you know, the rest of the book. Now onto the seven letters. So after this first vision of Jesus, he's glorious. He's like there's this great description of Jesus victorious in the first chapter. After that, it goes on with two chapters of short letters to the seven churches that were first addressed, the churches in Minor Asia that John writes to. And it starts off with a very personal, direct, prophetic word straight from Jesus. Imagine that. Straight from Jesus into the life of those churches. Each church is receiving a personal prophetic word straight from Jesus himself. And so the letters, they also kind of set up the main plot tensions, if you will. of the Book of Revelation. So you'll see the difficulty with false teaching and with persecution and things like that. You'll see them in the letters, and the churches are kind of addressed about how they deal with that. And you'll see themes like compromise and faithfulness and opposition and victory. And so we receive these seven letters now as prophetic encouragement, transcending the direct context and shaping and preparing us for taking part in the unfolding of God's story in the history of humanity. Every letter follows a similar pattern. It starts off with this view of Jesus. It connects that to chapter 1 and the first revelation of Jesus that John sees. So it takes part of that, and that's the introduction to the personal prophetic word. And then there's somewhat of a SWOT analysis, like a strength, a weakness, an opportunity, and a threat. And then it ends with a promise. So all these letters follow this pattern. And so we'll also follow that pattern as we discuss through the letters. And so every church is addressed directly and individually. But notice this. At the end of every letter, it says, hear what the Spirit says to the church, us. Not to the church, but the churches. So they get a personal, direct word. But all of the other churches also read those letters. And it says, this word is relevant, most relevant for this church, but it's also relevant for these other churches. In that sense, it's also relevant for us today. It could describe any church at any time. And so there's lots we can learn from these seven letters. All right, that was the introduction. Now on to the first letter, and that's the letter to the church in Ephesus. All right, so here it goes. To the angel of the church in Ephesus, write the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil, and your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear this with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles, but are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the works that you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. Yet this you have, you hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. All right, that was the letter to the Ephesians, the revelation letter to the Ephesians, not Paul's letter to the Ephesians. So just quickly about Ephesus. Ephesus was a big city in Minor Asia, what we now know as Turkey. It was a city of 250,000 people, so it's about the size of Groningen, a little bit bigger. And for that time, a huge city, a portal of culture and commerce and religion. If you remember from the book of Acts, when Paul was there, there was a big fuss because he was preaching Jesus, and Ephesus is the city of Artemis, with the temple of Artemis, actually one of the seven ancient wonders of the world. It's a big deal, really big temple. And they were really proud of that. They were really protective of that. So it's this city, this center of religious activity, of cultural activity, of commerce. It's an important city, not just in the Greek world, not just in that area. Also for Christians, it was an important city. It's one of the hubs, like Jerusalem and Antioch. It's a hub for church planting. It's a leading church. All the other churches were looking at what Ephesus was doing. It was like a central church. It was a center for leadership. It was first started by Aquila and Priscilla, who we meet in the book of Acts, and later by Timothy. Actually, when Paul writes his letters to Timothy, it's in the time when he is leading in Ephesus. So one of the main leaders was sent there to lead the church. It was a really important church, a hub. And we also know that the Apostle John spent a lot of time in Ephesus and in Minor Asia. And so it starts off with this picture of Jesus. So it's a picture of Jesus, then a SWOT analysis and a promise, right? So it starts off with this picture of Jesus holding the seven stars and walking among the seven lampstands. It connects to chapter one, first revelation of Jesus, you know, glorious, victorious. And this, the seven stars are the seven angels. Now, I don't really know how to interpret the angels. I guess it's like a guardian angel or a messenger angel. Don't really know how to interpret that. We'll leave that for another time. And the seven lampstands are the seven churches. And Jesus walking among them is a sign of his protection, of his presence, and of his authority. You know, he is in charge of the churches, and he'll, in his prophetic words to the churches, he'll exercise that authority. So then the strength. What is the strength of the Ephesian church? Orthodoxy. They work hard, they toil hard, they're strong in their opposition against the false teachers and the Nicolaitans. Who are they? We don't know. No scholar knows, but it's probably some early Gnostic group or something like that. But they're evil and they are false and they're distracting from the way of Jesus. And the Ephesus church is very strong at kind of opposing them and keeping the teaching of the apostles pure, and they're commended for that, they're praised for that, you're doing a great job, you're and this is probably very connected to their role in Minor Asia. You know, they were an example church to the other churches, and they were there, they saw themselves as protectors of orthodoxy. Great, good job, they're doing fantastic with that. But, and there's a really big but, there's a weakness, and it's a very, like, a big weakness, it's a big deal. Their weakness is orthopraxy. So orthodoxy is believing the right things, but orthopraxy is doing the right things. No, they're not doing the right things. They're believing all the right things, but they're not doing the right things. Jesus says, "This I have against you. You have abandoned the love that you had at first." So the faith of the Ephesians is strong. Their theology is all in check, but they are not practicing the way of Jesus. They're protecting the way of Jesus, but they're not practicing it. Wow, that's a big contradiction. That's a serious, serious lack. You know, and this verse is often interpreted as sort of like you've abandoned the first love, which could also be a right it's a translation in itself. But it for modern day readers, it makes us think of like the first, like an in-loveness, like. Like, do you remember when we were still in love? Like, do you remember when we first met? I sure do. It's a Jack Johnson song. Like a remembering of the sort of romantic in love time between two lovers. And that certainly connects also to our relationship with God. Like, there's a first, like when we became believers, or there was a time when really the fire kind of was burning in us, and we were in love with Jesus, and we were spending time with him all the time, we were adoring him, we were living for him, that first love. And and often it's said, like, we need to return to that first love, and I think there's a lot of truth in that. It's just not complete. The correct translation is the love you had at first. So not like return to your first love, but to the love that you had at first. So it's a bigger love than sort of an adoration for God. It's Christian love, which is loving God wholeheartedly, but also loving your brothers and sisters in the church, loving your neighbor as yourself. It's bigger than a sort of in loveness with God. Now, then there's an opportunity, and the opportunity is repent. Repent and do the works that you did at first. So it's also, it's a love that is expressed in choices, in priorities, in habits. It's a love that you can return to by way of choice and habits. It's not just a feeling type of love, like, oh, I'm so in love. It's a It's a practicing of love. So it's doing certain things. And then there's a threat. And this threat is a very serious one. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. So what does that mean? So the picture is of Jesus walking among the lampstands. The lampstands represent the churches. And then Jesus' threat to the church in Ephesus is, if you don't practice my way, if you just protect my way, but you don't practice my way, I'll remove the lampstand. What does this mean? Well, it could mean different things. It could mean their position among the other churches as a hub of leadership and church planting, of influence. It could also mean that Jesus would remove his presence, like church goes on, but the Spirit of Christ has left the building. It could also mean that he will remove his hand of blessing in such a way that the church will stop to exist in time, that it will be removed. So this threat, like any of those options, is a serious one, is a big one. And when they received this, they would have taken it very seriously. And it tells us that practicing the way of Jesus, carrying love daily, loving God, loving your neighbor as yourself, loving your Christian brothers and sisters, is irreplaceable. Without it, you're nothing. And it kind of confirms those words of Paul in 1 Corinthians 13. Like, you can have all the gifts of prophecy and tongues and do this and do that and do all these great things and give everything you own to the poor and whatever. If you don't have love, if it's not from a place of love, it's really worth nothing to God. So it really confirms those words. Okay, then it ends with a promise. And the promise is, those who conquer will eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. This actually look forward to the last couple of chapters in the book of Revelation. It's a pitch. So where the image of Jesus connects to the first chapter, the final part of every letter looks forward to the end of Revelation. So it kind of sets every church up in the middle. So throughout the book of Revelation, one of the persisting themes is that of a church conquering. The church is pictured in a constant state of war, like part of this cosmic war of good and evil. There are threats of persecution, false teaching. They threaten the church, but big picture of Revelation is we're on the winning team. We're part of this cosmic battle, and we're on the winning team. That's why it's encouraging. And I picture this church of Ephesus as very aware of this war and of the threats. They take it very seriously. Remember, they're commended. Their strength is that they're working hard, toiling. They're resisting the threats. So they're commended for that. They're doing a great job with that. So they're aware of the war. But Jesus is saying the way that you're trying to overcome is not the right one. You try to overcome by resisting, but overcoming is done in a different way. There's this threat even of the lampstand being taken away, because they're not doing it from a place of love, they're doing it from a place of striving. And to Jesus, the threat that's coming from within is even a bigger one than the threat that's coming from the outside. Conquering in this cosmic war, described so vividly in the book of Revelation, is not something that you do by fighting, but by being faithful to Jesus. Being faithful to Jesus. Not through a cold-hearted orthodoxy, but devotion to Jesus. Loving him. Loving your brothers and sisters. Resisting the ways of the world that is heading towards chaos. So I want to take a quick look at a scene a bit later on in Revelation, a bit of a prelude, and it's in chapter 5, and we get this picture of Jesus there where he opens the scroll which will unleash, the things to come and the disasters to come. It says this: "Look, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the heir to David's throne, has won the victory. He is worthy to open the scroll and its seven seals. And then I saw a lamb that looked as if it had been slaughtered.
But it was now standing between the throne and the four living beings, and among the 24 elders. He had seven horns and seven eyes, which represent the sevenfold Spirit of God that is sent out into every part of the earth. John hears about the Lion of Judah. You know, the Lion of Judah, this picture of Jesus' might and strength and, you know, conquering victory. So he hears about the lion, but when he sees a slaughtered lamb. Quite the opposite of a roaring lion. A slaughtered lamb. And the lamb is victorious. He's now standing tall. He has won the victory. Jesus overcame the powers of evil by his death and resurrection. As the sacrificial lamb, he conquered through suffering and faithfulness. The way you and I, the way we are called to conquer, is in the way of Jesus, like a roaring lion, as a slaughtered lamb. It's through faithfully following Jesus, living like Jesus, loving like Jesus, loving one another as Jesus would, that we conquer. The Ephesians try to conquer through fighting for truth. And Jesus tells them, it's good to stand for truth. It's good to resist evil. But you overcome through love. It's not just the resisting. It's overcoming through love. If love is absent, I will actually pull back my hand of blessing. So, lastly, we're coming to the end of this teaching message sermon type of thing. I want to end with three lessons for today that will help you in your day-to-day life and us as a church, actually. First one is spend time with Jesus for the sake of spending time with Jesus. That may be a surprising one for you. Spend time with Jesus for the sake of spending time with Jesus. You know, so often we pick up our Bibles or we take a moment to pray, you know, for something. We read for information. We pray to kind of get something, or kind of we hope to persuade God to do something for us. And the best thing about life with Jesus, is being with him, being present to him, being available to him, listening to him. Just spending quality time with him. That's what it means to be in relationship with him. And that's, I think, for a big part, what it means to return back to the love you had at first, to the things you did at first, is returning back to an adoration of Jesus, a being with him, a learning from him, a loving on him, abiding in him. In the letter to the Ephesians, Jesus says, do the works you did at first. And I think this applies to kind of daily habits of spending time with him. And actually, that's why I think this is such a good message to start the year off with. It's an encouragement from me to you, and actually to myself as well, to kind of return to the habits that you know are building blocks for your life. It's spending time with Jesus. Discipleship is not a course. It's not where you learn some theological truths about yourself and then you kind of willpower your way to live accordingly. That's not what discipleship is. Studying your Bible, learning things that are theologically true about yourself will definitely help you. But discipleship is a way of life. Living life with Jesus every day. And then these theological truths, you know, what he says about you will begin to take shape inside of you and will begin to form your life. Secondly, choose love over theological differences. And this really applies to us as a church, as an international church in the city of Groningen, 21st century. So we've got people coming from all over the world, literally all over the world. Every continent is present, except Antarctica, because, you know, we don't allow penguins. And so we've got people from all these cultures, from all these church backgrounds, coming with different ideas, perhaps even to the Book of Revelation, probably. And then we need to we may end up in, you know, conversations or maybe not so nice conversations with theological differences. How do we deal with it? I think what we're learning from this letter is that it's important to stand for truth, for, you know, against heresy, and we'll do that. I'm 100% for orthodoxy, but when there's differences of opinion about non-essential things, we need to see them in context. We need to understand, you may come from a different place, you may have different emphases. What can I learn from you, from how you see things? That's a better approach. You know, we need to let love abide in those places. Let it mark us as a community, certainly also in 2022. Lastly, we conquer through a beautiful resistance. The picture of the book of Revelation is of this cosmic war going on, powers of evil and the evil systems that are threatening the church, but that Christ and the church will be victorious in the end. Big picture of Revelation. And I think that in a small scale way, we may feel like that sometimes. We feel a bit threatened by the world around us, you know, maybe not by, you know, horrendous beasts that are about to devour us or something like that, but the culture that we live in is actually out to change us. To change us into, kind of deform us away from Christ. And so we need to be aware of that, and we need to resist the temptations or the threats of the world to commit to being formed after the image of Christ. And so we need to resist that. But this needs to be a beautiful resistance, not a cold-hearted, you know, like, I've got the truth and you're all going to hell type of resistance, but a beautiful resistance. Like, I'm going to do things differently. I'm going to be formed after Jesus. You do things your way. You do things the way you see best. And you tell me how it's working out for you. But I'm following Jesus. I'm following Jesus all the way. Actually, just to follow Jesus as well. It's the best decision you could ever make. You were called to live in a beautiful resistance, resisting the world and its ways, but not in an angry way, but with a tangible and a contagious love for Jesus, a love for one another, even when we're having theological differences, and a love for anyone that crosses our path. Let me put a comma there. We'll continue next week with the next letter. And let me end this message with a prayer. Lord, I thank you for this challenging and beautiful book of Revelation. Thank you for the opportunity to study it together in the coming year. And I thank you for this first letter to the church in Ephesus. What beautiful and important words that you're speaking there. And I pray, as we are starting off a new year as Vineyard Groningen, I pray that we'll be marked by love. And we'll stand for truth, but do so marked by love, in love. I pray that in this coming year, we'll take up habits again that just focus on loving on you, being with you, spending time with you, building our lives with you, building our relationship with you. I pray that we'll be people of the word. I pray that we'll be people of prayer. Lord, help us again to pick up those habits. I pray also that we'll be a church community that is known for their love for each other. And it's challenging when we're isolated from each other again, can't gather. I pray that it will soon be possible again. And that whoever sees us will see a love, an unexpected, you know, type of love, because we are people from so many different walks of life. We're marked by what binds us together, and that is the name of Jesus Christ. And lastly, I pray that we'll be able to live in a beautiful resistance, that we'll be able to identify the threats and the lies and the cultural patterns that are out to distract us and move us away from Jesus. That we'll live in resistance to that culture, but in a beautiful way, actually in a contagious way, that people are inspired by the way that we live and want to know what's behind it. Bless us, Lord. Amen. Amen.